Lactose is the saccharide that is present primarily in milk and is one of the main sources of energy during the nursing period in mammals. Lactose composed of glucose and galactose, and also important that lactose is a major source of galactose for human. So when we intake a glass of milk, for example, lactose incomes into the intestine. Because lactose is the saccharide, initially it must be degraded to monosaccharides. This degradation is provided by the specific enzyme lactase, also known as lactase fluorizing hydrolase. Lactase degrades lactose to glucose and galactose. Both of them then absorbed by enterocytes and metabolized by our organism with release of energy. And if in adulthood milk is not that important dietary source, during infancy milk is the major dietary source, so for the newborns the high lactase activity is absolutely vital. To understand the pathology, we have to know the general principle of enzymes regulation. When the substrate, as lactose, incomes into the intestine, the receptors sense income of the substrate, and this stimulates the expression of lactase gene that is located on chromosome 2. With increasing expression of lactase gene, the production of lactase enzyme increases. Thereby, we have enough amount of enzymes to degrade a particular amount of substrate. And in nursing period, when the major dietary energy source is milk, the income of the substrate is very high, and this causes very high expression of lactase gene, and thereby lactase production is huge. And as we know, after the nursing period, in the weaning phase, we add some fruits and vegetables to the dietary ratio. So the amount of milk and thereby the amount of lactose in dietary ratio progressively decrease. So with decrease in lactose, the expression of lactase gene decrease, thereby lactase production progressively decrease. And it was estimated that lactase activity declines after the weaning phase to less than 10% of the neonatal values. And with age, lactase activity decreases even further. This process happens in almost all mammals, including most of humans. So in the large majority of humans, lactase expression begins to decrease very early. Typically, this progressive decrease in lactase gene expression begins at 2 to 3 years of age and is generally complete by 5 to 10 years. This progressive decrease in lactase activity through life called lactase non-peresistence. And lactase non-peresistence have approximately 70% of the world adult population. In other 30% of the population, lactase activity remains high throughout adult life, and such pattern of lactase expression called lactase persistence. What we have to understand is that adults with lactase non-peresistence can hydrolyze lactose, but only in small quantities, because they have limited lactose digestion capacity. To illustrate this, let's suppose that 100 lactose molecules incoming to the small intestine, and lactase persistent individual has 10 lactase enzymes. And suppose that one lactase enzyme can hydrolyze 10 lactose molecules per minute. And let's suppose that time transition rate through small intestine is 1 minute. Basically, lactose digestion capacity will be equal to the amount of substrate, which is 100 lactose molecules, divided on the capacity of one lactase enzyme, which is 10 lactose molecules per minute, multiplying on quantity of lactase enzymes, which is 10. So in this case, it will take 1 minute to hydrolyze all 100 lactose molecules. Thereby, in 1 minute of time transition rate, all lactose molecules will be degraded and absorbed. But the major difference is that in case of lactase non-peresistence, the amount of lactase molecules not 10 but 1. So, in case of lactase non-peresistance, it will take 10 minutes to degrade the same amount of lactose molecules. Or if time transition rate is 1 minute, out of 100 lactose molecules, only 10 lactose molecules will be degraded, and 90 lactose molecules will pass through small intestine intact. And then they will enter into the large intestine, where they will accumulate and cause clinical symptoms. So, as a consequence of lactase non-peresistance, the majority of humans during adulthood are unable to digest all lactose molecules that incoming into the small intestine. Such people called lactose intolerant. So, as a result of lactose intolerance, pathological amount of lactose molecules enter into the large intestine, and when large amount of lactose molecules enter into the lumen of the large intestine, they cause some disturbing clinical symptoms. First of all, lactose is disaccharide, and disaccharides are in fact highly osmotically active substances. So lactose attracts and keeps nearby a lot of water molecules. thereby high amount of water will retain in the intestinal lumen with lactose and will not be absorbed, and this will cause osmotic diarrhea. Also, when increased amount of lactose reach large intestine, intestinal bacteria as E. coli percept lactose, and lactose for bacteria is basically food. And bacteria in large intestine do not have enough oxygen for aerobic fermentation, so the only way for them to degrade lactose is anaerobic fermentation. Initially, they secrete specific bacterial enzyme beta-galactosidase that degrade lactose into the glucose and galactose. And then these two monosaccharides undergo anaerobic fermentation. And by anaerobic fermentation, glucose as well as galactose are degraded to small chain fatty acids as acetate and gases as CO2, hydrogen and methane. So it's the end metabolites of bacterial fermentation of lactose. And because the amount of lactose is high, the bacterial fermentation results in massive production and thereby in massive accumulation of small-chain fatty acids and gases in the intestinal lumen. Most of small-chain fatty acids are removed from the colon through the absorption by the colonocytes. Another portion of small-chain fatty acids bacteria use as energy source for their purpose, and some of the small-chain fatty acids are excreted in feces. Accumulation of gases in the intestinal lumen cause clinical symptoms as abdominal pain, bloating, and distension. The small portion of gases is absorbed from the intestine into the blood, and through the blood they are delivered to the lungs, where they are excreted from the organism by exhalation, and this feature makes available to determine the amount of gas production in intestine. And to determine the concentration of hydrogen and methane in the breath, we use hydrogen breath test. Obviously, if the concentration of gases in the breath is high, the production of gases in the intestine is high, so it's an indirect method to measure bacterial gas production. However, the major portion of gases is excreted as flatulence, so this causes another clinical symptom, flatulence. Also, accumulation of hydrogen molecules in the stool will decrease stool pH, so it's a pathogenesis of clinical symptoms. But also we have to know that there are a few reasons why lactase level can be low. As we already discussed, lactase activity can gradually decline with increasing age. This process is genetically regulated. For now, we certainly know that lactase persistence is inherited as dominant trait and lactase non-persistence as a recessive trait. So humans that are lactose intolerant have two recessive alleles. Humans that are heterozygous can have partial lactose intolerance or they can be totally asymptomatic. And humans that have two dominant alleles are lactase persistent, so they digest lactose extremely well and they do not have any symptoms. And for now we have suggestions that initially all humans were lactase non-persistent. And indeed the DNA analysis of Neolithic individuals who lived across Europe between approximately 5000 years BC shows that all of them were homozygous for the lactase non-persistent allele, so they were lactose non-persistent. But with domestication of dietary animals, lactase persistent mutation occurred, and this makes sense because early the only period of life when humans consumed milk was during infancy. But with domestication of animals, a new potential dietary source in form of animal milk appeared, so now the ability to digest milk during adulthood became very useful. So this mutation was sort of adaptive response. This gradual decline in lactase activity with age called primary lactase deficiency. And because this decline occurs very slowly, it begins in infancy but clinically manifests only in adolescence. So in primary lactase deficiency, there is very long asymptomatic time period. Another possibility is that damage to enterocytes of the small intestinal mucosa can markedly decrease lactose digestion capacity. This damage can be caused by a variety of factors, for example due to a chemotherapy or in celiac disease, or such damage can be caused by infection as giardiasis. All these disorders cause severe damage to enterocytes of the small intestine. The concept here is that small intestine in normal condition is covered with mature enterocytes that in their brush border have very high amount of lactase. And in case of massive amount of lactose incoming to the intestine, they have enough amount of lactase to degrade it. But if damage to enterocytes occurs, the mature damaged cells are split off and are replaced by immature cells. And immature cells have very low amount of lactase. And in this case, if high amount of lactose incoming to the intestine, We have a lot of substrate but very limited amount of enzymes. Thereby significant amount of lactose won't be degraded, and lactose will accumulate initially in the small intestine and then will pass into the large intestine and cause clinical symptoms. So damage to the small intestinal mucosa causes significant decrease in lactose digestion capacity, and such condition called secondary lactase deficiency. And the third possibility is that mutation in the gene that encodes lactase can cause severe decrease or complete absence of lactase since birth. This condition called congenital lactase deficiency. And in this case, lactase deficiency begins and manifests right after the first injection of milk by the newborn. So in this case, in contrast to primary lactase deficiency, asymptomatic period is completely absent. Important diagnostic feature is that on intestinal biopsy, if lactose intolerance is hereditary, intestinal mucosa will be absolutely normal. But if it's secondary lactase deficiency caused by damage to intestinal mucosa, it will reveal damage to the enterocytes. The diagnostic options are lactose tolerance test. The idea here is that when person consumes lactose solution, it has to be degraded by lactase, and when glucose and galactose absorbed into the blood, it will cause increase in blood glucose level. And if lactase is absent, the degradation will not occur, thereby there will be no increase in blood glucose level. The second option is hydrogen breast test, and the third option is genetic testing to determine a mutation that is associated with lactose intolerance. And the treatment includes specific lactose-free diet and intake of lactase pills. There is very simple principle. To decrease the amount of lactose molecules that are left undegraded, we have two options. We can decrease income of lactose into the intestine, and we can achieve this by lactose-free diet, or we can artificially increase the amount of enzyme by intake of lactase pills.